I write a lot about climate change and environmental issues, and it can seem, I know, kind of hopeless in the world these days if you follow the news, especially if you follow it closely like I do. I'm here to say I do believe there's hope, and I think trees are one of the biggest objects of hope that we have out there, and I'm going to explain why. I have with me something called a smartphone, which I'm sure a lot of people here have. It's an amazing piece of technology. But I think that trees are even a more amazing kind of eco-technology, that's what I call them. And I'm going to explain, tell you the story it brought me to this and how I wrote the book that I wrote and explain to you what I mean by that. So, 2001, I wrote a piece for the Times about an effort to clone the largest tree of every species in the United States. This is the guy that was doing it. His name is David Millar. It's a redwood tree in California. And after I wrote the story, he got great play in the Times. He came to Helena to meet me. I hadn't met him, I talked to him on the phone, but there was a guy I did visit in Big Timber who was doing some of the work where they're gathering material from the trees and growing little trees from twigs. It's horticultural cloning. It's not the kind of cloning you think of when you think of Dolly the sheep. So it's very kind of easy to do. You could do it at your own home if you wanted to. So he showed up. There he is again, that's a copy of the book. This is one of the trees that they make copies of. This is called the waterfall tree in California. It's a sequoia tree, the largest single diameter tree in the world. So he told me the story about having a near-death experience. And when he came back, he had a vision that the trees were dying because of climate change. This is in 2001, and this is after I wrote the story, and I thought, this is interesting. Not a story you hear every day when you're a science reporter. So I didn't know quite what to make of it, and I wasn't even sure I believed it. But the story was science-based, and I talked to a lot of scientists, and they said it's a good idea to clone the largest tree to protect the genetics, because we know so little about tree genetics. About 4 or 5 years later, this is my house. You can see that little building there in the center, and these are the trees around my house near Helena. And what happened was virtually our entire forest, 15 acres of trees near Helena, died in a matter of a few years because you wouldn't know it today, but it's getting a lot warmer out there. And the bark beetles are taking over our forest in Montana. So it got my attention, and I started, and based on the story I had done and the things that I had heard from David, I started paying more attention to what was happening with trees and forests. I did a story on bristlecone pines, a picture of my son and daughter in front of a bristlecone pine that I visited for the story. This tree is alive, believe it or not, but bristlecone pines are in trouble. They're the oldest trees in the world. So when the oldest trees in the world start dying, and that's what the scientists say, they will all die in the next 10, 20, or 30 years. And my trees, and the story that David was telling me, it got my attention and it made me start to take trees very seriously and look at what they are. And that's what I hope to do with this talk, is to kind of move trees from a background in our lives to the foreground, because we really don't pay a lot of attention to them, and there's a lot there to pay attention to. Excuse me. So what have we done to trees? We've cut them down. This is a redwood, actually in Ireland, and this is David there in the middle on the trunk, but this is the kind of things, this is the way we've treated trees. And one of the things we've done when we've cut down trees is we've selected the best genetics out of the trees in our country and around the world, because those are the best trees for lumber, the biggest, the least diseased, and so forth. And so we've really kind of practiced evolution in reverse with our trees. We've taken the best and we've left the runts. As David says, the runts of the runts of the runts, because we've done it more than once. We've fragmented our forest. This is a picture of a forest in the Midwest. Or was a forest, it's farm fields. But what you do when you fragment your forest is you make tiny pockets of forest. They're very susceptible to warmer and drier temperatures. And they often will die out because they have no resilience. Now, what do trees do? What are the things we know that trees do for us? Well, one of the things we know that they do is they provision us. Cherries are one example of how they feed us nuts, other kinds of fruit, and so on. That's important. A lot of our diet, it's comprised of things that come from trees, apples. We may not think about it that much, but trees are important. They're not doing well on climate change. There was a study in Nature not long ago that Fuji apples are becoming mushier. They're harder to get crisp because the climate's warmer. Walnuts are particularly susceptible to climate change. They don't produce well as it gets warmer, and they thrive in a very narrow band of temperature. Maple syrup is another thing that trees do for us. This is a picture of maple syrup in New Hampshire, where not this past winter, but the winter before, the amount of maple syrup was 40% less because it was so warm in the spring. Trees stop flooding. This is a flood that occurred up in the mountains after a lot of clear cutting had been done. And if you look at flooding around the world, serious flooding, Cambodia, Philippines, and so on, and you Google deforestation, you'll find that a lot of the most serious flooding has taken place where there's been the most deforestation. The other thing that trees do we don't have a very good understanding of is create rain. And when you cut trees down, something like this, you change the downwind pattern and you change rainfall amounts. There was a study NASA did that showed that deforestation in the Amazon caused drought in Texas and New Mexico. And they look at these global patterns and they're starting to understand a little bit about them. But we really don't have a good handle on what trees do and how they create rain. They create rain both in a macro scale around the world, but they also create rain on a local level. So if you cut down trees, say in western Montana, you might see changes in eastern Montana. But these are, again, changes they're just starting to figure out. We also know that trees have psychological effects. Yes, psychological effects, which I think is very interesting. But a number of studies that show that having trees in the landscape can dramatically change the way people feel. In some, we've shown that simple and brief interactions with nature can produce marked increases in cognitive control. This is from a study in Science. It's a top journal. And what they see in places where they've studied this is that, for example, in inner city areas where you have landscape environments, you see more impulse control, less anxiety, less depression, even less crime in some places. So there is a kind of robust effect from nature and how people feel around nature, especially trees. One of the things we know about trees is how important roots are. We don't know much about the rhizosphere, which is what it's called, but we do know a few things about them. And one of the most important aspects of trees is that they filter the water that we drink. When rain seeps into the ground, there's something called a microbial ecosystem right around the root zone. And it's densely packed with these microbes, and they filter the water and feed it to the tree, essentially. The tree, in return, has something called an exudate, or a sugar, that comes out and feeds these microbes. So there's this very important filtering system that comes from trees. And it's not only the roots, the leaves as well are very important for filtering air pollution, especially in urban areas. Those are some of the things we know, a little bit of what we know. Here are some of the things we don't know. This is a willow tree, and some of you may know that aspirin was discovered in the bark of a willow. They powdered it, created aspirin, and of course it's widely used now. We also know that aspirin, especially lately we've learned, is a wonder drug. It's a chemo preventative. It prevents four or five different kinds of cancers. It's a pain reliever. Antibiotic. It can do a whole range of things. And so the question that I've asked and we don't know about is what effect those willow trees have on the environment. Now you have 300 species of willows lining waterways around the northern hemisphere of the world. What effect is that chemical having on the water? What effect is it having on the fish? What effect is it having on the wildlife? And what effect is it having on humans when we drink that water? It's not known. It's not been studied. So these are some of the things we suspect out there, but we don't really know. This guy's an oyster fisherman in Japan. The name of his group is Forests Are the Lovers of the Sea. He and a number of other fishermen read some studies that said that when a tree decomposes, humic acid comes from that tree, goes into the water, and causes plankton to grow exponentially, which means, of course, it's the bottom of the food chain, which the fish grow exponentially, and the oysters grow just as the same. So they went around, these fishermen went around Japan, and they planted hundreds of miles of coastline with trees to feed the plankton, essentially, recognizing this relationship between forest and sea. So they use these trees to reclaim sea life, which I think is pure genius. He won an award from the UN from recognizing this little-known factoid. One of the persistent notions of trees around the world, Native Americans, shamanic cultures, England, all over places I've visited, is that trees also are some kind of technology. They're somehow connected to the heavens. And that's something I thought, well, that's a nice myth, and certainly no way science could ever prove that. But I read an article, and I included it in the book, about this very thing. Cosmic Pattern to UK Tree Growth. This is from the BBC. It was a study done a few years ago. And what it showed is that the single biggest factor in the growth of trees in Scotland, spruce trees, not water, not sunlight, but it was something called galactic cosmic rays, which are high-speed particles that come from outer space. No one knows what they mean. It's not been studied beyond three or four studies. But somehow, there's a connection there, or there appears to be a connection. So this and the willow trees and these kinds of things are things that I think we should really try to understand more about trees and the role that they play in our lives and our planet. What do we do for climate change? How can we use trees to accomplish a lot of these kinds of things? Cool our cities, filter our water. This is something called the Fieldbrook Stump. This was one of the largest redwoods that ever lived. This is the town of Fieldbrook, or the children from the town of Fieldbrook, which is now gone as a community. And one of the ideas is to plant proven survivors, to take trees that survive the longest on our planet and to use them to reforest the world, to reforest the United States, to reforest our towns and cities. So this guy that I showed you the picture of at the very beginning of this talk cloned this stump. There are suckers that come off these stumps, and so you can take them and you can take and get those old growth genetics and you can grow new trees. So what they're doing is they're going to the biggest trees in California. This is one idea, by the way. There are certainly more ideas about how to reforest the planet. They're going to the sequoias, they're going to the redwoods, and they're going to other big trees, and they're taking cuttings, and they're growing hundreds of thousands of these trees as a way of mixing those genetics with other genetics and trying to create a super forest in some of these places, in cities and towns and in the countryside, to try and create forests that are best suited to survive climate change. These are some of the babies. These are redwoods. So we got cities all around the world that look something like this. And as it gets 10 degrees hotter or warmer over the next 100, 150 years, what do we do? What kind of technology can we take where 80% of the people in the world live, places like this? What kind of technology is best suited to try and help us survive the next century as it gets hotter and hotter? And this is it. And this is one of the ideas out there in terms of what a city might look like. This is a Photoshop and certainly a little bit exaggerated. But this may be the way that a city can survive in what scientists say will be happening in the next century. So I'm saying that give trees a second look, they might be far more important than we realize. Thank you. Mm-hmm.